श्रीमते रामानुजाय नमः। This is the second lecture in the series of lectures that we have organized here about consciousness and its application in various technologies. And this is the third lecture, if you include the ETH lecture also, the mind-boggling, confusing, a great, highly distracting lecture in which initially a floody throw of a special system, a very salid and mysterious dimension of science which the people have heard of a little or they have never heard of. When it was just thrown, it was just considered to be an aspirin demanding experience. And the second, it was organized here with a broader view, comparing with other technologies also. The more you hear, I think that it will be simple and sweet. And how many of you participating here in this conference, whether you have participated in the previous conference or not, that is not known to me. And even if they have participated, how much they are going to recall those things and connect with the present proceedings, that is also something very debatable. But still, I think that as it is a third lecture, certainly it will be more simple, shrewd, sharp and sweet, comparatively. So let us start with the idea of understanding the concept of global design of epistemology, the knowledge design. They consider two designs of knowledge. One is nothing and second is everything. And while considering this abstract base of knowledge as everything, it is in Sanskrit known as pujya. Pujya means that which is the substratum of everything. Second is shunya, that which is devoid of anything. So nothing and everything, shunya and pujya, they are one and the same. The quality of something being devoid of anything, that denotes the presence of everything in a special standard or a special setup. So there are two stages, that which is tangibly having everything, that which is in subtlety, which has nothing which we have seen in tangibility. So if it is nothing, that does not mean absolute vacuum or emptiness, that proves that tangible nothingness. So on the basis of these ideologies, there are four stages. Number one, the most primitive or primordial stage, where everything is very similar, where everything has no difference at all, that is known as sukshma tama. So in the basic level of perception of all ingredients, whether life matter or lifeless matter or epistemological stuff, whatever it may be, at the time of there was a beginning accepted by science as well as philosophy, where everything was equilateral, equipotential and equistatus in nature. Then in the period of evolution, there was a second stage in which that was subtler in the form of subatomic particles like nano, femto and pico particles which we are studying now. These type of nano, pico and femto particles, they are subatomic in nature, that's why they are known as subtler. These subtler particles, they expose lot of behavioral differences in the form of disparity in identities, identity among disparities, mutual adaptabilities and heterogeneity composite functional ability. So when particles of this layer are read, they are capable of identifying lot of disparities and identities and functional conjugational abilities. Then the third level is the subtle level, is the atomic level of study, which is well known to most of the people. It has been well exposed, atomic study is well exposed. The fourth level is the peripheral view which we are doing now. So we have to understand two points. Before the extremely tangible state, and as well as when compared to that of the extremely subtler than the subtlest primordial stage, there is a stage wherein by the infinite inherent potential and structural standard of different types of matters can be well understood and organized. One side is extreme tangibility, which is subjected to optical vision. One is extreme subtlety, which is subjected only to transcendental vision. In between these two things, there is atomic and subatomic studies, and atomic studies have been exhausted. Now we are in the era of subatomic studies, we are the minutest particles of the same atomic levels. Like I have already told, femto, nano, pico. So in this study, we have to understand how things can be united, how things can intermingle with each other and create a composite development in the issues of the global functioning. What are the issues of global functioning? Energy, health, exploration or expansion of possibilities in migration and settlement. So innumerable possibilities are there, which are endorsed by science and its development. The major thing is two. One is the energy to work, and second is health for our external and technical functioning. Health required for the technical functioning is known as energy. Energy required for biological functioning is known as health. So these type of major two things, apart from that of these major health issues, it is also red with the possibilities of expansion. Expansion deals with colonization, space exploration and various other issues. So taking these issues as the instantaneous, immediate or remote considerative issues for the development and the peaceful, harmonious and prosperous settlement of the mankind, this type of unison of the middle way, it is known as midway gate. It is in between the tangible and the subtlemost studies. So these two things, that is atomic and subatomic, between the subtle and the subtle level of studies, they are considered to be the study of the era. It is considered to be the exploration of the time, which is where we have to maintain various other things, take care of the crisis, also to govern various qualitative and quantitative struggles that we are facing in this world. So considering this, the Shastras, they give a very clear hierarchy of understanding these issues. One is Chaitanya. Chaitanya is consciousness. What is consciousness? What is cognition? What is intellect? What is intelligence? What is acumen? What is caliber? These things are very much confusing, but they are very simple. For example, consciousness is the basic quality of knowledge. Knowledge is to be aware of, and to be aware of what we are aware of, to have an extensive journey of exploration into the deepest zones and regions of the things that we are aware of. So, to be aware of one's own self, to have an extended awareness of the things which are around us, to have a deeper extensive understanding of each and everything based on their actions, inaction, reaction, interaction, counteraction and impact or consequential study, understanding of buddhi, structural and functional modeling and existence. So this is consciousness. Consciousness is the all-pervading, all-knowing, immanent, inherent, multi-poly-dimensional and inexhaustible in nature, which governs everything which is common with a lot of people. But depending upon, there are two limitations. One is the exposure limitation. Second is the spatial limitation. The consciousness level of the physical elements like pitch or the spatial need, they may not be having advanced these things. Second thing is, for human beings like us, even if though we are specially great or advanced, we have a demarcation which is based on exposure. So this is consciousness. And cognition, what is cognition? Cognition is the application tool of consciousness. For example, consciousness is the force. Consciousness is the force, and it is a quality of the soul. Cognition is applied consciousness. If I am seeing this, my consciousness is aware of this thing, like this is an element, it is a digital recorder, and the price is so much, and the company is this, and how to operate this. These things are various other intensive as well as extensive understandings of this product, and it is the tool of cognition. To cognize is to act with two things: one, the object; second, the viewer, that is the soul or consciousness, through the tools of the intrasensitive and extrasensitive backgrounds. So considering this eye, ear and other various other indriyas, what we call in Sanskrit, as the external tools, having connectivity with the mind as the internal tool, it is a voyage that takes place between an object to the subjective consciousness. Consciousness views this, taking the tool of mind with the connectivity of eye and other external resources, provided that the object is unconcealed, transparent and visible. So this is how an action takes place. So consciousness is an inseparable force of the spirit, and cognition is a tool or a spark of the force by which it observes through internal and external organs or devices. This is cognition. And when it is there, in understanding a particular thing, that is known as acumen. Acumen is the capability of a person's attentive and retentive structure. And caliber is a person's executive skill. If a person is having a clear-cut system of attending to things, observing things and assimilating things in the real manner, the person is said to be having a sharp acumen. Then the person's caliber is the executive possibility with precision and perfection whenever, wherever it is demanded, required. So that is known as caliber. Intellect and intelligence. Intellect is a tool by which things are made solid and sturdy. What is the difference between mind and intellect? Solid mind is known as intellect. When mind wishes to, mind is having two forces. Just as matter consists of three states, solid, liquids and gases. And vapor is the gaseous stage, and water is the liquid stage, and ice becomes a solid state. Likewise, the same mind, when it attempts to penetrate on something, when it attempts to contact on something, necessarily it should be. See, if you take a sweet, it should solve in your sublingual absorption. That is the nature. If you want to construct a house, it should not be soluble, it should be sturdy. So both the things are required for consumption and for establishment. Two things are required. In various other things, we are perceiving the same solidity and solubility. Likewise, the solid mind is known as intellect, and the soluble intellect is known as mind. Whenever we approach something to be known, immediately mind should flow there. Mind should flow inside there. So that's why mind is known as liquid. Mind is having the concept of flow, and intellect is sturdity. So you have to approach your mind for having the willingness or intention to know about something. Immediately the mind flows there. As soon you start perceiving on the additional information of these things, then the same mind becomes intellectually solid. That is known as solidity. Then whenever you want to output it, it should flow once again. So mind is having a very great functional structure, that it becomes intellect, determination, and active egoism or ahankara in Sanskrit. So the same mind, it should be, for example, I told you in a seminar on knowledge management recently, to get knowledge, you must have that solidity. To distribute knowledge, you must have the solubility. So solubility is the dimension of the mind by which we develop soft instincts like harmony, amicability, brotherhood, forgiving people, forgetting a lot of unwanted things, moving with the society, socialization, various other activities which are very good for a noble way of living and a harmonious system of life. It is everything contemplated only by the soft structure of the mind. Whereas mind is very much required to be very much solid and sturdy whenever it wants to analyze, scrutinize, assimilate, hold, apply, demonstrate, all of these various other advanced functionings of the mind, they require solidity. So the mismatch of the present mind is, they are solid when they see their brotherhood in the society, and they are very much molten when they are seeing the notebooks and school books. So whenever they have to approach, so a person should have an ambivalent or a bivalent type of acumen or type of executive skill or type of a bidimensional prowess of the mind, where he must be solid and where he must be slow or soft. So this is very much easily, I have already told you that you have to be solid and you must be soft. It is very easy to hear and easy to say, but how to develop this? What are the exercises? What is the time taken? From my level, present level, is there any gauging machine by which I can measure my present status of solubility and solidity? From this stage, how many years it will take for me to reach that stage? So what are the hindering factors? What are the environmental hazards and hindrances? How far I should take the tools for developing these things? So there must be an analytical and practical, what is what we call pragmatic philosophy, whereby we have to work out with the chart and make it fully successful. So this is known as intellect. Intellect is a person's ability to understand things, analyze things, disintegrate and organize things. Intellect is a person's ability to do. And intelligence is a person's achieved proportion or possibility for a person to do something. For example, if I can do, that is intellect. If I have done, if I can show you that I have done or I can do, that is known as intelligence. So processed intellect is known as intelligence. Intellect with is everybody, but intelligence is not so, because intellect is a crude substance. If intelligence is provable, available substance is known as intellect, provable substance and demonstrable substance is known as intelligence. So perspicacity is a person's high level absorption or a person's high level ability, whereby the person is of two types. One is stage evasion. One is stage evasion. Second thing is risk reduction. What is stage evasion? A person should go through stages 1, 2, 3, 4. If a person can have a special approach by which he can cross all these stages, jump from 1 to 3 or 1 to 5 or 3 to 5 or 7 and reach the benefit and also demonstrate the same to you, that is stage evasion. And second thing is risk reduction. We can do the same thing which you are doing, but without any risk, with rejoicement, with more precision. That is risk reduction. So perspicacity is a person's ability by which he can shuffle between risk reduction as well as stage evasion. So these are all the various things: intellect, intelligence, acumen, caliber, consciousness, cognition. These are all first some terminologies of consciousness we must be very much aware of. According to Shastras, I have already told there is a hierarchy. It starts with Chaitanya, your composite consciousness. The Chaitanya has three major ways of diversifications. The Chaitanya or the consciousness, it has three routes. One, it is going for self-introspection. It is going for understanding itself, number one. Second thing, it is for understanding the jadas. Third thing, it is for understanding the ajadas. When its process is replicated, when the process of the consciousness and the extensive applications of consciousness like observation, reservation, retention, analysis, mining, processing, simulation, imaginary vision, security, protection, preservation, then application and demonstration whenever, wherever required, these type of various activities, when they are replaced by a mechanical or automatic processing, this is known as artificial intelligence. So Chaitanya, or consciousness, when it is self-explanatory or self-expansive or extensive, it results in information technology. When the same thing deals with the minutest portions of life or ajada, it becomes biotechnology. If it deals with the fundamentalities of the jada, that is a matter, it becomes nanotechnology. So everything is very clear that it has a natural built-up inside. So if you apply the executive possibilities or the executive functional style of your own self in mechanisms, in automation, in processing in the form of artificial intelligence, that is info technology, that is cogno-info. Then cogno-bio, whenever you are dealing with ajada or life forms, there are only three things. One is Chaitanya Swavritti, Chaitanya Ajada Vritti, and Chaitanya Jada Vritti. You can only discuss about three things: life, lifeless base matter, and your own self-exposition and extensions. So if you replace this, there is artificial intelligence or computation skills which come under info. The second thing is bio, the third thing is nano. This is how we are getting the tree of knowledge from the cognition system or the cognotechnology. So if you understand this basic thing, immediately we can understand all of their interactive possibilities and their mutual realization, everything, etc., will be very easy. Then coming to the real point, there is one thing known as inquisitive design. I have already discussed that in the Science and Religion or Spirituality book. What is inquisitive design? Each and every person will be having an inquisitive design. That inquisition may be in music, it may be in athletics, it may be in domestic welfare, it may be in pets, it may be in forestry and nature, it may be in anything, etc. So first of all, we have to understand what is our inquisitive design. Then there are two more possibilities. Apart from identification of our own inquisitive design, how to reshape our inquisitive design, how to deepen and expand our inquisitive design, how to understand our own inquisitive design which is hidden inside the deeper murk of the conscience. So how to identify? I'm having an inquisitive design. How to identify? See, whatever you are just liking, they cannot be inquisitive designs at all. You may be liking cricket, or somebody may be liking playing in tennis or volleyball or something. Somebody may be interested in movies. So desire and inquisitive design are entirely different. That which you are desirous of is known as your own particular mania. That which you are disdained of naturally, configuratively, that is known as your inquisitive design. So inquisitive design, no doubt, that starts with a pinch and spark of desire, but anything that you are desirous of need not be your inquisitive design. So separately we have to organize a research and discussion about their own different and stabilized inquisitive designs of various people. So how to identify one's inquisitive design, number one, if they already exist and if they are manifested. If they are unmanifested, of three types: one, if a person is properly not molded by the academic and domestic dimensions, he may not be knowing what he is born for and what he is going to do. He may be having some inquisitive design. At that time we have to mold, or we have to identify that, number one. Number two, even people, they will be having two or three options. How to select between the inquisitive designs? Can they hold something bilateral? Can persons hold bilateral benefits? Or persons, can they have multilateral and polylateral executions with the same precision and reputation? For a lot of people, considering two or three things simultaneously, that will spoil the precision in the other. That will make them to go to nowhere because of their overconfidence or over involvement in various other diversified things which will dilute their potential of performance. It is with people. There are some people who are ambidextrous, who are multiversatile, but they are exceptional categories. So we have to understand, if a child is immature, a born child is immature, how to identify the implicit design or how to fix or configure our own implicit design and instill the same. So it itself is a very great task, Herculean task. If there is a child, how to identify its implicit prospective design or how to configure our own design and instill inside so that it can salubriously and successfully function inside the child, number two. Number three, if a person is totally unwanted by both the grounds of academic and domestic care, how to mold his. If a person is having multilateral options, how to select the best for the person. These things are in the implicit design. So if this implicit design is understood, lot of things can be accomplished. Lot of people, see, that's what I told in one seminar, most of the successful people would have been more successful if they are properly put in the plot. Most of the successes are underrated. We consider that they are very successful and we are assuming lot of great things because we don't know how they would have been more successful, how more people would have been successful provided the norms have been properly followed and nurtured from the impressionable age itself. That we don't know, then. Just what in one joke one person told, I'm a lakhpati, that's why I'm crying. Why you are a lakhpati and crying? He told that he was a crorepati before. Like that, we don't know what he would have been. What he would have been, if he would have been given, there are two things. There are some negativities and there are some positivities. If a scientist is succeeding in India or anywhere else, if the positivities are more boosted, then he would have created 10 or 20 people or he would have been 10 times more than what he has succeeded. And number two, if the negativities are not there, he would have succeeded more. Like that, positivity and negativity, this balance of equilibrium, if it is understood, there must be a school for scientific temper, pursuit and execution. For scientific temper, for scientific pursuit and execution, there must be a separate institute for that, because believing that scientific temper is innate, it is very dangerous. It will reflect only very few people, and most of the people will be just the burden holders like donkeys of the valuable stuff of the books, and they cannot have anything innovative at all. So there must be a special methodology of teaching for science itself. Yes. The Shastra says, Vasana, Ruchi, Pravritti, Bandha. If you are studying a particular thing, a faculty or a discipline, that is Vasana. That Vasana may be some imprints of your earlier births. Second thing is Ruchi. That which you have been exposed because of your family environment or the social environment, you are interested. Pravritti means you only got that opportunity. Lot of people going to BDS, they will say that they are interested in the teeth. Except close up or some other people, I don't feel that most of the people, they don't have any special interest in teeth. Because of non-availability of MBBS and other things, most of the people, they resort to BDS. But certainly that is also a subject of study. I won't deny because we can experience the greatness of teeth whenever we get some pain, some inflammation, something else, personal experiences. So I am not denying, but most of the people, Pravritti, because of opportunities, we are getting that. The final thing is bandha or coercion. Because we have to do something for surviving, no other thing is available. So Pravritti is some sort of necessity and opportunity, whereas bandha is emergency or coercion. So these things are known as inquisitive designs. Now, if one or two students are going to come for either practical learning of this cognitive technology to me later or towards a system or syllabus, you have to understand this implicit designing, and the option is only between these three, nano, bio and info. Application of cognitive technology is extremely meant for whatever I tell, even it may be religious, occultistic or philosophical, whatever it may be, application is very much restricted to either info technology or nano or biotechnology. So the systems are different. But the purpose is only between the three. I am not going to teach something for attaining something in sports or in religious practices, self-realization, liberation, etc. Application is very simple. It is one between only these three things. So next we are coming to, after this inquisitive design, we are coming to scientific pursuit. Because everybody, they cannot come to scientific pursuit at all. Scientific pursuit that requires a lot of self-interest, lot of sacrifice. Lot of environmental detachment should be there. So naturally that should be cloned within the person over generations, or it should have some environmental affinity also. That is very difficult. We cannot get from all people this scientific pursuit. It is not very easy. So this type of scientific pursuit, which we are going to, is everybody having that scientific pursuit is a question. Everybody, are they opted to science? There are several levels of science. One, One is the basic science in which we understand new things innovatively. Second thing is where we are creating, that is known as creative intelligence, I have already told. And studying about science and demonstrations for just a job sake, some promotion and settlement, that is entirely different. So there are a lot of people in scientific caliber, but all are not innovative and creative in nature. What we want is, we have to very safely complete the syllabus for the examination, get good marks and certification, and get settled inside a job. For that person, the requirement for a scientific temper or pursuit may not be more. He may require something very, very less. So this type of scientific temper, we can also segregate among the people how to understand the level of scientific temper required for the people. If somebody is very much satisfied with getting marks, certification and settlement, they need not engross into various other risky and arduous exercises. Those who want to achieve, three things. One, to create an innovative revolutionary model in the subject that we are taking, bringing pride to our land, to bring pride to the traditional heritage of our land. That is number one. Number two, already such a work has been done. How to create an advanced or upgraded version of the, same thing, and how to create a modified revolution in the already existing thing. And the third thing is very simple. Each and every global system consists of some common insoluble problems. So how to take care of these universal issues which everybody is doing the talk. So one is innovative research in any field. Second is upgraded version of the already existing innovations. Third thing is solutions to universal crises like energy crisis, like mind pollution, like the various problems of health hazards that are existing, challenging diseases are there. So if somebody takes that particular challenge, that person may require more guidelines. So this Cogno technology has two versions. One, it gives a preliminary study for people, those who are interested in handling issues of lack of proper memory, lack of intentional commitment towards education, and lack of rejoicement in learning. So even it, starting from the LKG till the college or doctorate level, or even in most upgraded offices and sophisticated service agencies, we are facing these three problems. One is lack of intention, lack of proper desire, or that driving desire is not there. Desire may be there, but the driving desire may not be there, number one. And number two, the person may be having some intention, but because of the person's intellectual imbalance, he may not do that. That may result in irritation, headache, inconvenience, and imbalance of the physical or mental status. So these things will be there. So how to get a person's memory, how to reboost a person's performance skill, and how to drive the intention. A person should have these three things. One is the intention to do. Second is the cognitive ability in the form of memory. Third thing is executive ability in the form of upgrading and updating performances. The more they demand, you must also simultaneously grow. So the growth of a person's automated skill commitment should be directly proportional to the market and official demand. So these three things are essential for all people. So it is known as preliminary service. This preliminary service can be given to all students pertaining to different levels. Second thing is sophisticated services of Cogno technology, which can be given only to people, those who are interested in giving innovative exercises, upgrading the innovations, or tasking or taking or tracking the global challenges and finding the solutions. So these two things are there. Very interestedly, we have to do that. And to brief about this Cogno technology, how to do that and what are the exercises. Number one, there is a hierarchy of functioning. We used to say it is, that is neuro, psycho, bio. This is the hierarchy of functioning. And onto, neuro, psycho, bio, this is one hierarchy of functioning. They say that consciousness directs your mind, and mind directs the brain, and brain directs the biological functions. This is our knowledge or emotions or anything that you feel, they come under this hierarchy. And there is one question, is there anything independent known as mind apart from brain? This is the number one question. Is there anything independent from the brain which is known as a mind? One, even if the brain is insufficient, according to the neurobiology or neurology or this neurocybernetics or any other multivarious dimensions which are emerging and which are existing, which are expected, they unanimously declare that brain is the substratum of all activities, and whatever you feel like anger, depression, then depreciation, frustration, solitude, mingling with people, happiness, all of these things are not qualitatively present there, but they are distinguishing and determining factors. They are fundamentally found in brain zones and secreted by various other neuronic substances and passed to various bodies by, that is, body particles by neurotransmitters. So it is a neural, neuronic and neurotransmittery work as per the present neurological sciences. Is there something mind known as? Then the Shastras, even the philosophy, they say that mind is more powerful than brain. Brain is an executive tool for the mind. So if it is so, even though if I am having lack of proper things in brain, can I simulate and stimulate the brain activities as per my desire and direction? There is a question. If my brain is insufficient, if there is a lock, if there is a cleavage, if there is disparity, if there is a blockage, if there is a channel depreciation, if there is any neural network deficiency or any innate problem inside me, can my mind independently has the strength, can it possess the strength so that I can simulate about my own brain without going for a scanning, any encephalography, magnetic or electroencephalography? Can I simulate that? Can I envision that? Can I induce my brain to do three things? One is, I already told, there is blood supply. There is energizers, lot of new energizers are induced in brain for having multi-connective nodules to perform. 20,000 networks are there in each and every node. Each and every node network not still will be having thousands of internal networks. So can your mind's urge internally contribute something to the brain to infuse more blood inside? For example, by doing Shirasasana or Dhyana, the efficiency of the mind should make the brain in three things. One, the already existing brain structure revealed. Number two, the already existing brain structure boosted. Number three, already existing debilitated brain structure, it should be ability should be made more. It should be vitalized and invigorated. Is there any possibility? Can a minus become a plus? Can a plus become double plus? Can I understand first through the mind introspective exercise that whether it is plus or minus? These three questions are coming in neuropsychiatry, that is psychoneurology, that deals with mind being a capable tool, having its impact on the neural system. And neuropsychiatry deals with the brain and its impact on the mind-connected emotions. So neuropsychiatry deals with brain as a leader and the byproduct of mind and its emotions, whereas psychoneurology that deals with mind as the major tool and which directs this neural network to undergo neural, neuronic and neurotransmittery activities. So it is very much interesting also. Number two, there are innumerable people, those who don't have the cognitive ability, reception and reaction. Cognitive ability, reception and reaction. Who are all they? Number one, a person mentally retarded. Number two, a person who is immature because of his age, I have already told. A person who is having tetraplegia, totally paralyzed. A person in coma. And a person who may be crooked in mentality. A crooked person's mind, because he won't be having the cognitive ability. If a person is crooked, he will not be interested in transformation. He will not be interested. So, a crooked person or a corrupt person, a person in coma, a child which is immature, and the brain or conscious level of plants and other subhuman species, and various other tetraplegia, bipolaris, then various other problems like mental delirium, schizophrenia, etc. For these people, how to induce the mind? Plus or minus, plus be made as double plus, and plus to be minus to be converted into plus. How these things are possibility? This possibility is understood in Shastras as well as by parapsychological exercises by means of external induction, by inducing the person from a secondary force on it, which we are going to read later. So that is also possible. So let us come to us. We are normal. That means most of the times we are normal. Nobody is normal. As most of the times we are normal, we are most of the times we are healthy, we are claimed to be healthy. Sometimes we also have the reflections of coma, lunatism, crookedness, immaturity, schizophrenia, all of these resemblances are there, but the only greatness is we are repatriated, or we are rebrought to our senses, we are reclaiming to our originality within few minutes or seconds or hours by an internal compression or by means of a solace or by an external consolation. We are coming back to our original configuration. So everybody is like that. So those who are irretrievable, they are told to be lunatic and other thing. Retrievable lunatics are known as human beings or normal beings. So far as how to develop two things. How to develop two things. For example, I have already told, even it may be BE or MBBS or CE or any examination, intention drive, memory drive and execution drive is a problem. It is a universal problem. Like global warming, whenever we see the books or examination paper, there is a neural warming. It is universal. So how to tackle this neural climate change or neural warming whenever we are exposed to classroom and other things, and the same joy that we are experiencing whenever you jump out of the classroom should be there whenever you are getting inside. So this is very common. So how to get this intellectual sturdity and this mind power by which we can bring everything to concentrative attention? How to bring them into concentrative attention? So there is one question asked by everybody. Recently somebody asked me, you are telling that my mind is weak and you are willing me to, just advising me to make my mind strong. Already I am weak. So how a weaker person can be strong enough to make his mind strong? So you are telling that I am weak. How I can make myself strong? The Shastras, they give answer for that. It is known as, see, a person is very weak. Physically, the whole body is weak. He cannot just move. But he is taking that energy drink. Because the adoption canal, what is the adoption canal there? There the drug is given through oral delivery. It may be intravenous delivery, it may be a hole insertion or a semi-invasive fixation, neuroprosthetic, whatever it may be. The person is having an adoption channel. What is it? Adoption channel. Even though the person's whole body is weak, if an energy drink is given to the adoption channel, immediately that supplies that energy to all parts, immediately the person is okay. Likewise, even though if you are weak, there is an adoption canal which may not be weak for most of the people. So the adoption canal which is going to receive that strength dosage is ready for all of the people, provided that is given in a palatable, appreciable, admirable and jubilant methodology. That we have to invent a new methodology in which we can very jovially, see, if it is too jovial, then it will become a fun and we don't have any essential absorption at all. If it is full of stuff and essence, it will be a punishment in disguise. So we have to create some sort of a semi-serious voyage in which we learn everything, but learn things with simple and sweetness. So this adoption canal is where we are having some sort of hope or possibility, where we can believe that we can become strong in spite of becoming weak or being weak. Because of adoption canal, that is, what is our adoption canal? It is our urge, it is our desire, it is our will. That adoption canal, if it is properly used, we can get lot of these benefits. I will tell you few exercises. There are four major exercises. One is calmness. It is very much told in the Shastras and it is very much perceived in the society also, to be calm. To be calm out of irresponsibility, out of sluggardishness and out of lack of interest or some other non-commitment, that is entirely different from this type of calmness. This type of calmness is not a recreative, it is neither a sluggardish nor irresponsible in nature, it is an active calmness in which you take a step of tranquility by which you are getting lot of things which is inside you to organize your own self in a very fantastic manner, which you cannot do even by hundreds of exercises outside. So four exercises. One is calmness or tranquility exercise. Second thing is visualization or internal stimulation exercise. That is also very much essential. Third thing is cognitive drilling exercise. Fourth is the vision. So there are 10 or 15 exercises for becoming calm. To become calm means you should not have any binding factor like appetite, like thirst, like various other biological instincts, like irritation, some other commitment. See, somebody is asking you to do something in the office, so you must not observe calmness, saying the Swami has told me to become calm. So without any commitment, without any internal demand or external demand, you must be in a convenient position to sit and decide about this calmness. So every time, the calmness is of three types. One is thinking about something that is calm in nature, like a nature that I feel that I will be more tranquil and complacent if I am there in, say, a forest or inside a valley or in a plateau or in the backwaters or anywhere else except my home and office or school. That is one model. It is searching an environment. And second thing is, wherever you are, you can just sit quiet for half an hour. Whenever you are going to write an exam, whenever you are going to read something, after being exposed to reading, writing or analysis, getting yourself calm will naturally, see, you need not organize anything at all. Naturally, the mind can organize itself. All these stuffs can be organized itself. All data can be organized by its own nature. That is incidental data, chronological data, biological data, observative data, experiential data, everything can be arranged and organized by its own self. But you must allow some time for that. So sitting inside calmness is a good exercise. Daily, at least, it is the first step. In calmness also, there are innumerable calmness exercises. You cannot directly go for the 10th exercise as you are not exposed with natural calmness. Natural calmness within your desired ability is not administered by you. So going for advanced techniques is very impossible for you. So the third type of calmness, the first type is searching an environment. Second thing is suiting or tailoring one's own environment. The third thing is to create an internal drive by means of mantra or yantra, pujana, bhajana, bhojana, what are various things are there. So taking something which you consider to be a driver, either you can practice or somebody can induce as an inspiration model, you can get all of these things and you can make this thing possible also. So this is also a type of driver to get that calmness. If you are having that calmness, now the next, if we are going to discuss, it should be about the calmness exercise alone. But that should require a marker and I have to write that, because that will be full of exercises. That is not in the form of narration. That should be in the form of exercises, how to develop calmness. Anybody developing the calmness, number one, they will be able to get visualization. For example, if they see about, for example, any person, really it happened. That's what I told in Serendipity. Most of the scientists, their interventions or inventions are very limited. They have been driven by their intuitive will. Due to their overlonged or prolonged desire and commitment towards identifying the product or identifying nature of the element, they have been totally lost in the space, that is lost in space. They have been totally lost in space, complete detachment, total focusing on the same thing. What is this? What is this? Without knowing. There are two things, without any input and with inputs. Without any inputs, lot of people, without any devices they have invented. Now we are having devices, already existing inputs in the form of networks and as well as research publications and various things. The problem is at that time, as they were not having all of these things, their handicapped nature, the lack of proper inputs, lack of proper devices, as they are handicapped, that has created an additional zeal. That has created an additional zeal by which they succeeded. The natural available demanded zeal itself is diluted now, so we are not able to function. With the 2x, the zeal got that zeal multiplied into 10x and they performed. And 10x, even if it is given supplied to the modern people, they will dilute it to 0x or minus 1x. That is the situation. In spite of having, we are struggling in spite of having lot of inputs. We are having the dynasty of various inventors. We are having the total continuity of various sex and dimensional views of the various things by various universities we are having. Still we are struggling. Everything now we are having microscope, we are having computer for processing, storing, identifying, modeling, everything we are having diseases. They did not have because they had the internal courage. They had the internal source. The internal source is very much important. So somebody asked me a question. Already we are struggling with the books. If you are going to teach something else, will it be really something complementary? Or will it be a load, additional load and burden to our already existing thing? Somebody asked this question. You are teaching something which we don't know. From our elementary class, we have been studying about science, biology, at least the names we have heard, and we are processing towards a very great NH road, having a very similar and homogeneous observation and practice. The thing in which we have been dwelling and practicing for the past 10 or 12 or 15 years, even we are struggling in that. You are going to teach something which we have never heard of, which is anonymous and cryptanonymous. You are going to teach something new. It is an alienistic science. So how we are going to master it? If we are going to master it, would it be a cognitive load on us? Certainly it will not be so. Because real education will make you to go for additional resources. What is additional resources? Number one, that's what I have seen in few people. In my younger ages, I have seen in few people. Whenever you see, if you are given some school textbooks, you are given one or two school textbooks. I have seen two or three people among thousands who are not satisfied with the textbooks. They will go for library, get some books and get additional informations. They will ask more questions and widen the knowledge. So additional resources, whenever you get a book, the book should give you dissatisfaction, you have to go for additional resources. That is the real methodology of study. Even if the book is a burden for you, that will be the time for a person to see it or to realize about additional resources. So cognotechnology is a technology by which you are taught how to handle and organize the stuff in a simpler and sweeter manner. For example, if you don't know about something, certainly you will get that fear. For example, I am simplifying you something. I am bringing your caliber to the level of the stuff level of the syllabus. Then it becomes simple. Whenever something becomes simple, that becomes structured. Whenever something becomes, if it is well taught, if it is psychoanalytically taught, understanding the caliber level, intention level and receptorial level of the student, if it is taught methodologically, that becomes simple. If it is taught simple, that becomes structural. You know, yes, then why is that? You know the order, sequential synthesis is made. If something becomes simple and structural, naturally that becomes sweet. Something that is simple, structural and sweet, that becomes encapsulated inside your mind. I want to say one something, encapsulation or sangrahana, it is a very great skill of human mind. According to Shastras, it is known as essential absorption. I want to clear something. If there is 1500 words in a stuff, it is enough if you understand 20 or 25 key words inside that. Your essential absorption memory understands only the key points. Whereas the microneural epistomes, what are the epistomes? Epistomes are like protons and neutrons. Epistomes are the knowledge particles. So these micronutrient epistomes inside your brain are cognitive ether that will re-summarize, elucidate, expand and restructuralize the things that are hidden inside you. Don't think that you have to understand everything. If you are having a book of 200 pages, that 200 pages can be encapsulated or the essential absorption can be made within 10 or 15 pages. If you remember the 10 or 15 pages by means of your cognitive programming, suddenly at the time the micronutrient epistomes of your cognitive ether, they will try to expand and present it in a fully structured, reorganized manner with fullest precision. That is possible by that. So you are not understanding that type of system, you are not having that cognitive taming of your mind or brain or intellect, due to which you suffer with this other. So this gives you the clear idea that cognitive training or cognitive technology is not an additional burden for your already existing syllabus, but it converts the already existing so-called burden in the disguise of a boon that you are expecting for a job or realization or scientific success. It is going to convert that burden into a blessing, a rejoicing. The same cognitive technology, if it is applied to your 5 years of study, with lesser risk of studying, more impact of deeper or prolonged memory, more precision in your performances can be guaranteed by this cognitive technology. What are cognitive technologies? I have already told about cognitive technology in the previous lecture. Applying technology or technology driven softwares, for example, there is an acharya, there is a teacher. In his physical, human, biological form, by means of his mutual sharing in the form of instruction, methodology and approach, the person is teaching you with his three things. One is his inspiration. Inspiration is possible only by a person's presence, a person's radiation, a person's erudition, a person's compassion, and a person's interactive skills and mutual affinity. Can a software represent all of these things and replace them? Whatever your teacher is going to teach, that can be replaced by a computer or a software. But what about the magnanimous shape and structure? Whether the teachers are having these things or not, I don't know. But for an ideal teacher, but for an ideal instruction methodology and learning methodology, the teacher should have the pleasing experience. And this pleasing experience will make the person to attend the classes in spite of his physical unwillingness or physical unwell conditions. In spite of being ill, in spite of being unwell mentally also, the person should be driven to go to the classroom. So a person's appearance, experience and mutual affinity, this cannot be replaced by a computer or a software. I have already told about CogniFit. The previous lecture I told about CogniFit. It deals with phobic erosion. How to erode phobia in chemistry, physics, mathematics, etc. How to simplify and understand mathematical problems, logical solutions and algorithms. How to construct that. It will also guide with you. How to master languages. So there are various other things which are given for various demonstrative and learning exercises. Now I am going to tell you about that cognitive technology. Technology, what is technology? Applying a tool for getting something is known as technicality. Technos is known as A designed tool, and engineering is a process of designing a tool. So a tool which is meant for everything is a technology only. Even if you lever, even if you make a small rod to hold a stone and pull something, even that is a tool. So tool is of mechanical tool, there is a manual or innate tool, it may be automation tool, it may be a sensor tool, it may be an artificial intelligence tool. 5 sections of tools are there: innate tool, mechanical, automotive, sensorial, and now we are having artificial intelligence and advanced simulative models now. So whatever it may be, it is a tool. I am going to teach about that cognitive technology in which you use yourself as a tool. Just as a person getting jute will get jute from the forest, bind the jute with the same jute. Like that, mind is not only the tool to understand everything, it is a tool to manifest, manipulate and man its own self. So understanding the second dimension of mind, first dimension of mind in cognitive technology is understanding mind as a tool for other technologies. That is, mind can have 5 dimensions. One is inert, second is invert, third thing is inhibitive, fourth thing is innate, fifth thing is inventive. These are all the dimensions of mind. What is it? Inventive. I can invent a bike or an automobile which can run with 100 kilometers per hour. That is my inventive mind. This mind only, this body cannot run with the speed, but this mind has invented an automobile which can run with the speed. This is known as inventive caliber of the mind. Number 2, inhibitive caliber of mind. I don't know to invent all of these things, but if something is there, I can identify it and use it. That is known as inhibitive. I don't know anything, I want to sit quietly and enjoy my life. That is inert. And other thing is innate. The same thing, you have to understand this, I want to repeat it twice. Everything that you have designed by your mind, any device, irrespective of the function or functional precision or status, can be administered by the same mind itself without the aid of the device. That is known as innate. Follow that. Whatever the mind devises, the devising mind can be a good replacement for the device itself, provided the mind is so deep, strong built, well organized. If the mind can invent a television, the mind may also have the function of the television. That cognitive technology I am going to state, and also in that I have given 3 things. One is spiritual, second is sophisticated, third thing is simple or preliminary. I don't know how many of people you are going to come to spiritual, I don't request or compel them also. Sophisticated, 1 or 2 people they can come, but for simple and preliminary exercises, for making education rejoiceable, to widen more in their applications and scientific temper, to have more deeper thinking, to have a more broader vision in bringing real harmony and productivity to the society, the simpler exercise of cognitive technology can be used. So what is the innate dimension of mind? Whatever the mind devises, the same mind can perform the device's performance. So this type of functional ability or functional excellence of the mind at par when compared to that of the devices that have been the products of the mind. So it creates an equilibrium like E is equal to MC square. The producer is equal to the product. Both the producer as well as the product, they have equivalence and hypervalence. Even we can say they have hypervalence. The more the mind, it can detect about new thing. For example, I can travel in space, in transportation, space exploration, television, telephoning and communication networks, whatever we have invented. I want to conclude, I want to say that the mind has not only the ability to make things which can do, it is having also the ability to do. So it is having 2 dimensions. One is endotechnical, second is exotechnical. Making things which can do is known as exotechnical services. We make ourselves to be capable to do. If we do, that is endotechnical. If we make things which can do, they are exotechnical. This is that type of cognitive technology we are going to teach here today. So cognitive technology is not like that at all. And the fifth thing is invert, I have already told. Instead of understanding about the world and other things, the mind thinking about the soul and the Brahman or reality and going for liberation, emancipation, that is known as invert model of mind. So mind has inert model, which is very abundantly present. We are having also inhibitive people. Thousands of people are working in offices and they are good users of the utility members of the devices. And there are few people who can invent, there are very few people. So it is a division. One is inert, more than that is inhibitive, more than that is inventive, more than that is innate, more than that is invert. This is the type of cognitive technology which is not there. I want to boast the glorious tradition of our land. It is a new type of dimension in the whole society. With this ideology, we are going to get the things. And there are two questions, which is avyapti and vyapti. What is avyapti and avyapti and ativyapti? That is non-pervasiveness and over-pervasiveness in logics. Somebody asked a question. If you are saying that this mantra, dhyana, everything will lead us to science, then why most of the people, what is ativyapti? Most of the scientists are not, Indians are not masters of meditation. That is ativyapti. None of the Indians are scientists. None of the meditators are scientists. That is avyapti. None of the scientists are people who are in meditation and spiritual exercises. If spiritual exercises can give you clarity in science, then there are two problems, logical fallacies. One is, most of the scientists are non-practitioners of these exercises. Most of these practitioners of these things, they are non-scientists. It is known as non-pervasiveness and over-pervasiveness in logics. Then we answer this question very clearly. Scientists, they are getting the benefit because they are having some similar structures. Similarity, continuity and maturity. If Albert Einstein and Isaac Newton, Dalton, Niels Bohr and various other scientists, they have achieved something else, that may be due to three reasons. One is similarity. Even though they have not practiced these things, they would have similarly contributed something which is replaceable or substitutable. That is similarity. Second thing is continuity. Already they should have done something and it is continuing in this process. Maturity. Already they should have done and continued, and this birth they are maturing into getting those benefits. So without having that similarity, continuity and maturity, they should not birth that. In also divine worship, I told about God's worship, Ninanti worship like this. There is sacred worship, secret worship, system worship, simple worship, similar worship, later worship, associate worship, innumerable worships are there. Those who are not thinking about God and those who are against God, well, after telling something about God, abusing about God, they will say, oh God, please forgive me inside. That is secret worship. Sacred worship is very much austere, principled, everything, etc. Sacred worship. Systemic worship is living a life without harming others. That is not a system worship. Similar worship is, even though a person is not loving God or worshipping, they are caring for the society. They are caring for the diseased. They are caring for the downtrodden. They are loving nature. So loving God in a different form of the downtrodden people, elite people, loving God in the form of knowledge, loving God in the form of mercy and nature, that is similar worship. So they should have got some secret worship or sacred worship or system worship or similar worship or later worship. When the youth and the youth cholesterol that melts away, naturally there will be some insecurity, and the only person available for solace is God. So any person at the age of 60 or 65, whenever a person is growing old, naturally we can predict that he will be God-binded, or whenever a person is God-binded, we can clearly predict that he is getting old, mentally or physically. And associate worship, the persons will not worship, but their wife, children, the family people, they will do additional penance for this person's longevity and prosperity. Even if he would have given the opportunity, he would not have done so. So most of the things are, even for the most the communists, atheists, rationalists and various other members of the society. That's what I told in a story, a person, an atheist, climbed a hill and he was about to fall. And lot of the other people who have gone for the picnic with him, they just instigated him to pray for God for mercy or pray for help. He did not do at all. At last, by his own personal strain and effort, he climbed and he was saved by himself. And at last he felt, oh, thank God I did not pray for you. So like that, this type of worships are there. So why scientists, in spite of their non-practice in meditation and other exercises, how they succeeded? Because of the similar forms of worship or later forms of worship or associate forms of worship, they have understood. And why these people, those who are having this meditation and other exercises, why these people they have not succeeded? Why they have succeeded, I have answered. Similarity, continuity, maturity. Why these people they have not succeeded? Because of lack of desire, depth and diligence. They should have some desire. Even though if you do meditation, for example, if you plow your land, it does not mean that coconut or mango will grow by itself. You have to cultivate the seeds. You are having meditation. You are having a provision for understanding. But you did not think about the world. You did not think about atom. You did not think about life. So desire was not there. Lot of people are thinking about the world and other things, but the depth was not out there. That craving was not out there. Lot of people are thinking and thinking, but they don't do it in practice. Lot of people are speaking and thinking, but not doing practice diligently. So continuity, maturity, as well as similarity, that has created success in the Western world where these sciences are not available, cognitive technology, in spite of availability of millions of treatises, as well as traditions and lineages of spiritual good dynasties, still these people, they have not succeeded because lack of proper design, lack of proper determination and diligency. So if there is a bridge between the desire, diligency, as well as the determination of a person with the prescribed exercises, we are going to create a de novo model. That de novo model is going to be a very great, wonderful thing, which is going to create that vision. So next time we are going to discuss with the calmness exercise and various other issues. Now, coming into a very small conclusive session, you know that bio, nano, info fields, they are mingling between each other. Each and everything I have already told, this is Chaitanya Jata, Chaitanya Ajata, and Chaitanya Swapravritti. Chaitanya Swapravritti, Chaitanya Jada Pravritti, Chaitanya Ajada Pravritti. So there is a natural combination between this convergence, even at the time of creation. Whenever there is a temptation to know about the self-analysis or self-executive replacement or self-executive representation, along with the representation in life primeval units and matter primeval units, it is there in the structure of the creation or structure of knowledge itself. It has been realized very later. Now recently we have understood, but the creation started wherever we have entered in starting thinking about the convergence. What is the world knowledge system of our country that started with only NBIC convergence? Bhokta bhogyam preritarancha matva yushta tatastena mritatpameti bhokta bhogya prerita. Prerita, information technology. Bhogya, all other material devices, that is nanotechnology. Bhokta is the chaitanya, that is the life. Life for experiencing things. So that is known as biotechnology. So bhokta, bhogya and prerita is information, nano and bio. So the whole system of creation itself has started like that. In applications, you may be knowing as you are reading the same syllabus. And also I want to say something. We want to have a team of people. For example, if biotechnology that demands use of nanoparticles, that demands use of information technology for more processing, then the person already who is struggling and suffocating with the biotechnology should have advanced knowledge or additional knowledge in other two faculties also. So that is an extra demand. This growing convergence, apart from your faculty, by an interdisciplinary study. Interdisciplinary study is entirely different. I want to give you a clear definition of cognitive technology, which I mean. Interdisciplinary study is entirely different from fundamentality study. Find a fundamental spark or a fundamental spirit from which life sources, material sources and knowledge processing sources, they emerge. That is our cognitive technology. Already emerged things are there. How to use between them for getting benefits is known as interdisciplinary study. So we have to, for example, to get a nano project, sophisticated nano project done, there are two possibilities. You should require a person who is skillful in nanotechnology, biotechnology and infotechnology. Otherwise you should have a team, like-minded, compatible team of three persons who can work together. But more than that, it is known as parallel emergence. What is it? Parallel emergence. In cognitive psychology we say parallel emergence. See, somebody is in biotechnology, somebody is in nanotechnology. Both of them are working in nanobiology, for example. More than their joint working, if your person is having both the skills inside, a nano person also having knowledge in biology, if he emerges in something, it will be more innovative, more deep and apt. Coming from two different sources, the compatibility, understandability and the environmental conduciveness, everything will be there. If it comes from the same mind, it is known as parallel emergence. A person knowing both the things, if the person emerges in a solution, that will be more appropriate, that will be having a lesser risk. So Dura Drishti is later vision, Aghata Drishti is deeper vision, Samakra Drishti is composite vision. This composite, deeper and all-round vision is only possible if the person has parallel emergence. How it is possible to have parallel emergence? Already the particular thing which you have taken is a struggle for you. You are fighting with the syllabus. How you are going to take the other things for common study? So that proves that unless you master cognitive technology, which will make your weightlifting championship just as easy and as facile as a feather growing exercise, it is just Pakshadbhana. a feather blowing exercise unless a person undergoes a training for at least 6 months or 1 year of his cognitive development skills. By means of which the person can handle all of these things, it is very difficult for a person struggling with one technology to have a similar idea of parallel emergence with the other connected technologies. Number one, recently in the areas where they can work together, I can give some projects as well as some exercises which can be just explained in the next session. Number one, now they have identified some fluorescent polymers in nanospheres. With these fluorescent polymers, they can clearly identify these metabolites. What are metabolites? That which are governing to be the reasonable faculties or reasonable factors for diseases and disease-causing environments inside the body. In the metabolic activities, they are known as metabolites. By means of this nanosphere fluorescent structures, that is the polymers, we can identify them very easily. By means of which, as these nanospheres and these fluorescent polymers, as they are parts of the biological assay, there is a biological assay, biological structure. As it is a part of the biological assay, they are non-harmful, they are precise, they deal with the extract morbid rosin, so that they can be very precise in diagnosis as well as treatment. At the time of diagnostic delivery, they will be precise. At the time of drug delivery also, they will be more precise. It is the use of polymers, fluorescent polymers of nanospheres. And second thing is, now we are having conjugation of natural antibodies which are there inside with nanoparticles. It is known as antibodies nanoparticles computational modeling, in which a particular antibody of our system can deal with one more nanoparticle, provided that there are two conditions. One is affinity, second is specificity. Affinity is both of them should mingle together, and specificity is they have to work for the common cause by means of a ligand bonding, that is known as reception ligand recognition model. Reception ligand recognition model. This is a model by which the mutual affinity between the antibody of the body along with that of the particular nanoparticle can be mingled together, which can be used for detection as well as treatment. And third thing is, now by means of the advanced bio-nanotechnology, they have invented immunodiagnostic bio-nanosensors. And fourth thing is, there is bio-nano-complex studies. What is bio-nano-complex studies? This biological matter and this nanoparticle matter, they must be understood with three factors. They are mixed with a covalent bond, the bond structure of an antibody along with the nanoparticle, creating a covalent bond which has three qualities. One is compatibility between each other, second is solubility in action, third thing is biodegradability. If it is not soluble, it is dangerous. If it is not degradable, that is also a dangerous hazard to body. So it should be compatible for becoming effective, for preventing from side effects. It should be soluble and also degradable. So this thing is produced in latest bio-nano complex devices. And fifth thing is natural or inherent affinity. Naturally, God has created in such a manner that selected antibodies of the body are responding or recognizing selected nanoparticles. Naturally, it happens so. So at the basic level, everything is having some sort of adherence and admiration naturally. Recently, they have made a research in nanobiotechnology lab of Southern California University, where the immune system of a mouse, a particular antibody that has proved its bond affinity of 25 nanometers with C60 furans. So this is also possible by means of mutual affinity. We are not uniting it. Naturally, at the basic level of the biological subtle matter and particle subtle matter, matter subtle matter, they have a natural bondage. At the time of our informative or intellectual subtle matter, they will have a bondage. So natural, this convergence of cogno, nano, bio and info is very natural, which we have understood after so many centuries. So this is something known as nano-bio convergence. And next, we are also having, apart from this, some information technology utilities like that of molecular dynamic simulation. What is molecular dynamic simulation? If a particular nanoparticle that occupies a selected minutest spot of an antibody, it occupies only a limited space, leaving a big area for interactive studies. There, various interactive behaviors and disciplinary studies in the vast area can be very effectively visualized and monitored in the study of the molecular dynamic simulations. Apart from which, in simulations also, information technology, it has very wondrously resulted into the minimization structure of 300 times. 300 steps of visualization has been recently done by people. So it is known as a deepened descent model and Newton-Raphson model. Recently they have invented, before 1 year, two models which are known as Newton-Raphson model. Second is deepest descent model. In that model you can minimize. How many times? You can minimize to the proportion of 300 times. 300 times of miniaturization is possible. And it is known as stochastic boundary molecular dynamics model. It is stochastic boundary molecular dynamic model. This thing has been now recently developed. And apart from that, in the complex system of bio-nano system also, there are two possibilities. One is the resorption area. What is the reaction or resorption area? And second thing is spherical reservoir area. And this is also, these two zones are differentiated into two regions. One is the region of reaction, second is the buffer region. And this atomic behavior by means of two dynamics. One is Langevin dynamics, second is molecular dynamics. Applying these two dynamic principles, the atomic structures of the first area, the first region, it is used for propagation. Propagation of signals, processing, everything, etc. Image transmission, etc. In the second area, that particular element or the atomic behavior is retained by using harmonic restoring forces. So, some area in between the bio-nano complex, there are two things to be done, propagation and retainment. If everything is propagated, there is no retainment, there is no use, because it will hold on everything. If everything is retained and not propagated, the signal processing cannot be done. So by means of propagation, which is done by molecular dynamics, retainment of the essential factors by harmonic restoring factors is done by means of, by the bio-nano info level, you can go to that level of identifying which you want to retain, which you want to propagate, because you can go to that level. For example, if you can suck your flower, can you get that honey? Because only the honeybee is having such a minute sting by which it can select the pollen, extract the exact honey that is present. That part of sophisticated system is available only with the bee. So if you go in the bio-nano level, what to retain, even if there is a connectivity of intimate bonds, having at least, for example, 0.000, we can put 10 or 12 zeros, to the level of a micro spatial gap between these two bands, you can select one thing and you can just neglect the other thing, which you cannot do in tangible devices. So in the nano level, retainers and propagators are well identified. Now we are having lot of nanoparticles for gene delivery. We are having nano sensors which are compatible with the molecular compounds or molecular structures like DNA biomolecules. We are having nano sensors for biomolecules, nanoparticles for gene delivery, and lot of newly bio-nano machines are developed for space applications. Everything is going on in the society. Recently, lot of people are doing researches. NASA Research Institute, they have funded for terrestrial or terrain manipulation and climate prediction, etc. They have instituted two projects. One is the all-terrain astronaut bio-nano gear system. They have developed an all-terrain astronaut bio-nano gear system. And the Terra Explorer system, they have developed a Terra Explorer system. It is funded by NASA Institute. And National Science Foundation, they have developed a project. Now they are developing a project for protein-based nano sensors and nanomotors. Now the project is with the 15 billion, they are doing the project. They have to complete it by 2011 or 12. So this is a project available like that. And number two, I want to say, there is also one NAGBO project in which new or novel or improved nanoparticles, chemistries, and apparatus for nanobiotechnology. The project is known as, I told the expansion, abbreviation is NAGPO. Novel and improved nanoparticles, chemistry, and apparatus for nanobiotechnology is known as NAGPO. It is also in the process. The third thing, Dr. Chi Ming Ho of the California University, he is a great scientist in microelectromagnetic field physics. He has developed a lot of new models. His recent development is micro and nano fluidics. Micro and nano fluidics. How convert everything into fluid or flow model so that to have a target delivery of either a drug or a diagnostic tool. So now he is also doing in the similar research. Like what innumerable researches are going on in various parts of this society. Now coming into the nano, bio and information technology, I want to put it in a very clear-cut method. Number one, the body is full of lot of micro factories. The body is full of, what is body? Body is a cluster of innumerable congregations, knots and module conjunctions of sophisticated, complex, intricate, inexplicable, mysterious micro factories. This is a definition for body, biological definition for body. Lot of such micro factories are there in the body. Each and every cell is having intricate multi-connectivity networks with a lot of signal processing. Each and everything is like that. Can we identify them? We cannot identify. First of all, what I have told is about bio. Body is a set of cells, and each and every cell is having lot of signal networks and various other channels. This is bio. But by using nanocytokines, you can induce the microsystems of the body to create a desired phenotype by which we can understand these things. Number two, this is nano. Third thing, by means of a simulation, you can organize as well as adjust the functionalities inside. This is info by which we can understand the destinal modularities. What is it? Destinal or control modularities of the human body, which are all the determinant factors of human life and functioning. This is the convergence. So, to start with, understanding about the body and complex network is bio, and having a deeper study by means of imparting a nano cytokine particle by means of which the desirable phenotype is induced by the microprocessing units inside the body is a nano, and observing the same thing by a simulation by which we can adjust, monitor, associate and organize the functionalities inside is info, by which we are arriving at the novel, unidentified, mysterious, as well as the basic structural novelties and nodalities of the human body and human life can be understood. That is a convergence. So for understanding this human life as a whole, it is proved that bio, nano, info, it is very essential, unavoidable. I have already told, in one convergence people told, cognotechnologists will think, biotechnologists will analyze, nanotechnologists will execute, and info technologists will monitor. So to think we need somebody, to analyze you need somebody, to execute you need somebody, to monitor you need somebody, like Chaturbhuja of Vishnu, in which he is having Shankar Chakra, Gada and Padma. We must have a Chaturbhuja Siddhanta in technology also, in which these four things are united to create something. So this is very much essential. So nanoparticles of silver, aluminium oxide, single-walled and multi-walled carbon nanotubes, along with gold particles also, titanium dioxide, innumerable things they are used now. And recently, there is Dr. Jacob Oswald is the research and development wing director of the US Army, and he has proposed application of these bio nano info technologies into various areas, like number one, war. In war, to get information, to transform information, for information security, for making bio nano sensors or astronauts or space vehicles or space drivers or space monitors, and also for our own various other methods of propaganda and reconnaissance, etc. In war it is to be utilized. And number two, on environment. In environment also, for degradation measurement, for considering about the bio remediation, for landscaping and land planning, for water resources management and water utility, everything for distribution, it is very much required in environment. In installation services like transformation and power units, it is very much essential. In information technology also, for high performance computational areas like geospatial engineering, it is very much essential. So this bio nano info technology has become all pervading and all essential, and it has such a very complex system which can enroll into the process of governing the all-round benefit of various emerging systems of the world. That is the greatness of this technology. Apart from which, I want to say something very simple. If a person should understand something about nanotechnology, the person should have got a taste at all. Basically, there should be a taste. Without a person, most of the people like J.C. Bose, Alfred Einstein and Albert Einstein, then various other people, the great scientists, they have got some sort of thirst as well as taste. Thirst as well as taste towards nature. For example, J.C. Bose, you know how much he loved plants. Apart from studying, how many botany students are loving plants? They are touching plants because of compulsion of experiments or some projects. Otherwise, nobody is interested in seeing plants. So we must love, if you are studying biotechnology, naturally you should have an inclination towards life. You must love life. You must be surprising at the wonders of the life. You must be shocked by the mysteries of the life. You must be kindled by the orderly presentation of the life and its expansions. You must be thirst about knowing life more and more. Unless you have these jills, who is going to implant this jill at this age? I don't know. So unless you have some sort of craving, that like thirst, some trial pursuit or instinct inside you, you cannot love something. Unless you have this thing, you cannot understand biotechnology. See, trusting biotechnology inside for exams is different from understanding biotechnology and becoming a shining student. You can nobody say, that's what I told. There are lot of urges. Like competition is an urge, coercion is an urge, inspiration is an urge, emergency is an urge. So by these urges you can be driven to write some examinations or study something. Like nanotechnology, whenever you see that there is something subtler than the subtlest particle, immediately you must be having some love, some thirst, some sort of mystery, some sort of craving, some sort of some driver you should possess for understanding these particles, either info, cogno or anything else. So the driver, you should sit calm and develop to see the driver which is already there inside. Nanoparticle means you all know that it is 10 to the power of minus 9, 1 billionth of a thing, you know that. It is a so minutest particle, somebody said in an example, it is the amount of hair that grows in your face in the time taken by you to lift the razor to your face. So the amount of hair that grows in your face in the time taken for you to lift the razor to your face is known as a nanoparticle. How you can understand this thing? So now nano you are suffering. Thinking about nanoparticle itself is a very great danger to our thought. And nano devices, not only particles, nano robots, robots in the size of the nano. And I have already told you are going to come into, apart from nanotechnology, you are going to reach the other pico technology and frontier technology. It may come in future also. So how we are going to do with these things? So whenever a thing becomes the most lightest or subtlest, certainly there are two things. Lot of people, they will be afraid of big things. Lot of people, they will be liking big things, something big in size, something more colorful. See, each and everybody will have some taste. Taste for colorful things, taste of different things, taste for big things, taste for small things like that. You should have a nano desire inside your mind by which you can understand nanotechnology. Bio desire for biotechnology, info desire for info technology, cogno desire for cogno technology. These things are the real drivers by which you can reach the state itself. So something the Shastras, they say that yes, sukshmaha, sottamaha, that which is sukshma is uttama. Likewise, nanoparticles also, they say that nanoparticle is light. As it is light to handle, it is also strong. As it is light and strong, it is also clean. Not only light, strong and clean, it is inexpressive. Not only light, strong, clean and inexpressive, it is also precise. So this type of particle is light, strong, inexpensive, clean, as well as precise in its functions, by which we are developing these things. And it is there everywhere. Nanotechnology is not only in medicine, nanophysics, nanochemistry, everywhere it is there. There are a lot of nanotoxicology is there. In molecular self-assembly, supramolecular self-assembly, and self-assembled molecular layer or monolayer studies, and nanotechnology of DNA. DNA nanotechnology is there. Studying of DNA nanotechnology is there. This thing is in biology. And second thing is nanoelectronics has come. Nano circuitry is there, nano lithography is there, apart from which nano ionics is there, like bionics, there is nano ionics, then molecular electronics, microelectronics, everything they have come into vogue. And by means of scanning tunneling, as well as atomic power, visualization of scanning probe models, we are seeing a lot of things in nanoparticles. So it should be driven by a desire to understand the existing, number one, three things, to understand the existing ones, number two, to continue with the existing ones, third, to create a destination wherein you achieve something, accomplish your individuality and your uniqueness. So you have to understand what you have been taught. Number two, you must understand how to carry on with your intuitive guidance. Number three, where is our destination? What we are going to intuitively design and we are going to develop to create our individuality or uniqueness. That is known as innovation. So these three things come from that nano desire. This cogno technology is the technology by which we are going to teach you how to develop this desire based on the inquisitive designs. And coming to this final bioinformatics, it is about understanding about the biological systems by means of information technology. Basically, you know that all the biological systems, they cannot be easily evaluated or they cannot be easily envisioned or equally structuralized. It requires some systems of data mining. It requires algorithms. It requires computational mechanics. It requires statistical studies. It requires simulation models. And it is required for finding, for viewing, for mapping, for comparing, for analytical studies, for everything we require some sort of modeling, which is by information technology alone. By means of this information technology alone, we are understanding three things. It is known as PSG. P is the protein, which is the basic energy level, and S is the sequence and structure, and G is the gene. So bioinformatics can be very clearly, very precisely noted as PSG model to understand about the structure and functional sequential order of proteins and genes of our structure. It is there in sequence analysis. Now there is a shotgun sequence analysis recently they have introduced. There is sequence analysis, and second thing is it is having annotation, genomic annotation. Third thing is it is very much used in computational evolutionary biology. It is there in understanding about biodiversity, in preservation of the DNA as well as the genomic material of the endangered species. It is there in biodiversity. It is there in understanding about the adaptation of our analytical study of mutation in cancers, understanding about regulations, understanding about genetic expression, protein expression, genal and protein exercises and structures. It is very much useful. It is useful in comparative genomics. It is useful in biological modeling, like human atlas, human map, life atlas, life structure, life module, life graph, everything we can understand to create new parts, to produce similar parts, to induce longevity in the existing part, to create an elixir, to extend your life, to repair the process, to create auto-receptivity and auto-repairability inside. Everything it is very much useful in this biological modeling system. Also, it is used in the high level performance of throw-out imaging system which is existing now, which is known as biomedical imagery, which is in cytohistopathology, morphometrics and DNA mapping, etc. It is very much useful now, and it is used in protein-protein docking, and it is also going to be useful in the process of chemoinformatics. Now there is clinomics, there is proteomics, there is systemics, there is biocybernetics. Innumerable systems are emerging there, giving us lot of hope to learn. But these things are just frightening the people rather than brightening their standards of caliber. Whenever I say new subjects, immediately the people are frightened. Oh, this is one more headache which you have to take later. So this type of fear is created because of they have lost the taste buds of knowledge, recognition and relishment. There is a taste bud inside, just as we are having tongue taste buds. There is a cognitive taste bud which makes the person to crave for more knowledge. No, I am dissatisfied. You teacher, teach me something more. The teacher should be afraid. Now also they are afraid in a different context. They should be afraid on seeing your extraordinary receptivity and craving for more knowledge. So these new dimensions, innumerable dimensions are also coming now. So to really conclude that, I want to say three things. There are some exercises which I have mentioned. In these exercises, very simply I want to say, one exercise I want to say very simply, whatever you want to know, you take a lesson that you have to only see, there must be three things. One is specification. Second is practice. Third thing is report or follow up. If it is not there, then there is no classroom or there is no lesson or there is no impact at all. Specification means I cannot teach a common lesson. Somebody may be having a trouble in somewhere, somebody will be having some sort of joy there, somebody will be having a double trouble in the same place. So it is different. So you select a lesson. This is specification. Whatever I say, you have to practice, that is true. And I must be reported either through mail or any other communication that whether you have got some benefit or not. Whether you have got some benefit or already existing benefit was looted along with this practice. I have to be clearly informed what is happening there. So you take a subject. You take a subject. Subject itself is very exhaustive. So take a lesson. Now I have given you various exercises. Now I have quoted. But still, unless you just write down everything, you may not be knowing. Even I may not be knowing what I have told just before. So in that position, to understand things. Second, to have a casual memory without thinking that you are holding. For example, if you are having a fracture, you will be having a pain to hold this hand. If you are very normal and casual, are you feeling that you are carrying this hand or this neck is holding this head or the hip is holding this body? Are you having something? Because it is a component of the body, it is a compound structure in which it is casually holded, which will not give you some sort of uneasiness. So memory is also a part of your cognition. Your cognitive space can accommodate in its 0.1% all the published works which are there in the global libraries. That much you are having a space. That is the greatest thing. I told one lesson I conducted on confidence to 10th standard students. I told there are two initial steps for confidence. That your mind is all powerful, your brain is all powerful. These are all the first two steps of confidence. You can do, but you are not doing is the essence of this confidence exercise. So you take a lesson, and just write the important points of the lesson in a paper. That caliber, that lesson should be a one-to-one challenge. So you take such a lesson. So practice it with calmness exercise. For example, you sit just 20 minutes in a calm posture without doing studying or thinking. Don't think that you are calm. You must be too calm that you are not thinking about the calmness also. So you sit there and make yourself relaxed, then go through that. And then this one exercise number one. Number two, you take the vital points. For example, I told about computational evolutionary biology. I have given a name. But what is biology, what is evolution, what is computation, we don't know. Just we spell the words. So you select 10 or 15 words where you are not understanding the concepts. It may be whimsical or it may be quixotic for you to accept my exposition now. But I think that it is really true, and you will also know the same if you practice it. Just you think about the word without thinking about anything, without any inputs from your book. Do it for 10 days. You will see some wonders. Certainly somebody should see some wonder, positive wonders. So you take the key words. You take the words which are observing to be challenges, not as words, but as concepts. If you say nanobiology, that word is not a problem. Somebody told you, how was the question paper? Somebody asked somebody else. He told the question paper was okay, answers were problem. Question was not hard. Like that, no word is problemsome for us. But that answer may be problemsome. So the second exercise, first exercise is, before studying the challenging lesson, you take the rest, complete calmness for 15 or 20 minutes, then read that. Don't try it. There are three things: to read, to study and learn. To read, to study and learn. Just going through the thing is to read. First you have to read. Then after pacifying your emotions and volcanic burst, I already told neural warming, after everything happens, then with a little bit acquaintance of verses and phrases, you go through that. That is studying. Then after that exercise is over, third time it is learning. You practice these three things with a gap in between, as well as before and after. This is over, first exercise. Second exercise, it is very wonderful. This is you are learning, studying and reading at least. After everything is learnt, see, if you have studied and learnt everything, it is enough if you read it at the time of examinations. If you are reading daily, then you have to study and learn at the time of examinations. If you study and learn and master the things at the time of learning, there are two times. There are two timings. One is the timing where you have to produce it. The second time is where you have to reproduce it. When the teacher is teaching you, whenever you are going through the same syllabus at your house for your homework or for reading or for anything else, whenever there is a teacher and student subjectivity in a subject, that is known as producing moment. Whenever the class, either a narration or interview or examinations, you are asked something, that is reproducing moment. At the time of producing it inside or installation, if it is learnt, you need not learn it at the time of examination. You throw the books away. At the time of examination, if you read, it will come. Or you have to at least study. No need to learn it again. But it is not so. The second exercise is very simple. You take few words, 20 or 25 words. They must not be mere words. They must be connective concepts. For example, if you say Bohr's atomic model, then that is not only a word which is connected with model or atom. It connects with a system of presentation with a diagram and functional structure. So take such a word which has intensive coverage. Don't take small words. If I want to take you some good words or some risky words, you should not take some philosophical words which have no extensive or intensive ruling. Take some words which have intensive dimensional coverage. Like it may be heading of an experiment. It may be heading of a synthesis or hypothesis. It may be the heading of a law. So without looking the book, I swear in this stage, I believe that it is the stage or the podium or the platform, everything to be the personification of wisdom. I will wish that you will also experience the same. Without looking the book, you just think about the concepts without thinking anything. Law of conservation of energy, what is momentum? What is momentum? What you do and be? So if you are going for auto-suggestion or self-suggestion, you may get something good or something wrong, something deviating or something confusing and something totally stagnant and still. But still don't forget that. In the first exercise you will not get that. Then every house will have two instincts. If everybody in the first exercise, if they can get the cognitive ability, every house will have two instincts. And three Osama bin Ladens. If the thinking is more. So it should be very processive. If you don't process, there are two possibilities. You will be overproductive or over-aggressive. I have given examples for both the things. So take the process. So if you think about these things, I believe after 10 or 12 such exercises of 20 or 15 minutes each, don't sit for hours together and don't throw it again. Sit for 2 or 3 minutes, make it 5 or 10. Gradually you develop the exercises, introspective exercises where you are trying from a blank with your word, without any input you are trying from a blank. You will get two benefits. One, if you are so benefited or if you are so blessed, you will get whatever you are there having in your notebook or no, having in your syllabus. But that thing is far remote. But I am assuring this benefit, second benefit, whenever after doing these exercises, if you look the book, that will go as if you have cut cheese inside your mouth without any strain or struggle. And whenever you study that, even though you would not have thought the same thing, you would have traveled only in blankness, you may not be knowing the same thing, but whenever you feel some sort of affinity and brotherhood in the stuff as if you have read it before. The first benefit is, you will get the same law of conservation of energy without seeing the book. That is divine. Just for a manual exercise and for your human visible benefit, the second benefit is very simple. You can feel as if you have learned this several times, and that will be a cheese cutting exercise, and that will be very smoothly entering inside your caliber, making you more effective. So with these two exercises, we can start the calmness exercise, and in later sessions we can discuss about other things. Narayan, Narayan.